Our central banks, through the arm of the armed forces and other military aspects, control everywhere that there is a central bank. That's why all the countries and empires that we get all of our resources from have a central bank there, followed by a military base or some type of military to control the bank's resources. The country is the bank's resources. Through the World Bank and the IMF and the International Monetary Funds and all this stuff, when they give money to a country and control it through debt, it gives them the right to take their resources. So as long as the Fed, i.e., central banks, have that control of that region, that's why you're seeing what you're seeing. It has nothing to do with mismanagement. It's a debt scheme. It's a scheme to control the masses and the people. So what's happening is when the day comes, you're not going to ever see a collapse. What you're going to see is an all-out grab. Like that show that just came out, that movie, whatever it was. What was it? The fifth wave.
Right.
And the fifth wave was when they send the troops in to physically go and get the stuff. Well, that's what's going to happen here. That's why I say there's no collapse. Anything you see is manufactured. When they're ready to turn off the things and start the people, they could do that today or tomorrow. They could shut the banks down in a second. That's why you're never going to see bank runs in the US. It's impossible. They've created laws and legislation to make it impossible. You saw what happened back in 08 when they rushed WaMu and a few other banks and tried to do that. You had dudes stand out there with machine guns and they had the bank shut down. You couldn't even go up in there. That's because they control it all, and they were letting you know by show of force how much deep we are down this rabbit hole to the point of no return. They control everything. And when they are ready, they will roll out the new system of electronic where you won't be able to transfer funds or do anything without going through this new mechanism. And that's what Bitcoin and the cryptocurrency serve to do, to prepare the people for the new economy, the new mechanics of the new economy. And the cryptocurrency mainframe, the way it operates, is going to be the new currency. We knew this back in 1994 when I first got my introduction to Wall Street. That was one of the first things they talked about. They had a conference and they were talking about that. That was back in 94. So that's how long they've been working on
But
this.
using the cryptocurrency isn't, there's no real central area for the system to work. It's diversified among many.
Again,
So
it's the mainframe. It's not the actual Bitcoin itself. It's the new it's the idea of it. It's the mainframe, the mechanics of it. And it is not centralized in the way you think. It's centralized through this new thing is going to be through the central banks, just like it is now. And they're going to have, how can I say this? They have these machines, like when you go to your when you go to the store and you check out. Well, if you notice lately, all the terminals, regardless of what store you go to, are starting to look kind of the same. The checkout thing is kind of the same. Some places, like if your card has the chip in it, you got to put it into the chip reader. You see how that's becoming main around everywhere you go? Well, that's the same way this new monetary system is going to be, except for it's going to be more control because they want to have more control over the money. They want to know everything about it. And with it, I mean, it's really, I go really into depth in my series on There Is No Collapse. I go really into it. But for the most part, it's trackable. It's wearable digital technology that has your money and you combined, like your Social Security number, if that makes any sense to you. It's really like space agey, out of this world, but it's already exists. It's ready to be rolled out at any time they're ready to roll it out.
Revelation chapter 13, verse 15. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save that he had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Shalom, Akiam. This is Ariella. First off, I want to give all praise and glory to Yahweh, Bashem Yahweh Shai. Once again, I want to give all praise and glory to Yahweh, Bashem Yahweh Shai. I want to send double honors to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. I want to send much peace, love, and salutation to all you brothers around the globe, pushing the word of Yahweh, Bashem Yahweh Shai, in sincerity and truth. In this edition of World War III Algorithm, we're talking about the Mark of the Beast. And if you brothers have been following the algorithms through the spirit, you know, that I put together, we're still in the period of that we call the calm before the storm. You know, while all these geopolitical moves and economic moves are being made, in the back end, you have the elite and those who are ruled by the spiritual demon Satan preparing for what they want in their new world order, okay? And a part of that is the Mark of the Beast system, a whole new governing system and regulated system of commerce and economy, because the way you do your economic business pushes how you do your military business, pushes how you do your social work on the people, okay? And when you look in the scriptures, they were always fighting over that region in and around Israel, because that was an epicenter of commercial traffic and knowledge and wisdom, man, because everybody was there, okay? Now, when you look at the IMF upcoming in the next couple of months, the IMF is said to have a few meetings and announcements made, along with China and Russia making moves at the same time. So we're gonna see. One interesting thing is this article right here on the IMF website, imf.org, IMF meaning International Monetary Fund. In January, they came out with this right here, and the title of it was Virtual Currencies and Beyond, Initial Considerations. You know, you brothers can type this in and read the full thing. I just wanted to highlight some of the introductory type stuff and kind of go into it and its relevance with the RFID microchip and how the scriptures explicitly talk about this. You know, Revelation 13 is pretty much a famous scripture. And the microchip is such a blatant, you know, seemingly obvious prophecy that it's so in your face, people don't want to believe it. People don't want to believe that the elite of the world would be this ridiculous. As if destroying, you know, billions of people isn't ridiculous. As if the transatlantic slave trade and the murders that they conjured up for you so-called Negroes, Latinos, and Native Americans wasn't absolutely ridiculous. As if the pollution levels from all these industries that are created with capitalism and how they're destroying the natural way of being and natural way of life on the planet Earth isn't ridiculous. GMO foods, hole in the ozone layer, the chopping down of trees and the eliminations of whole ecosystems, you know, that's not ridiculous to you? So you telling me a monetary system that's gonna be integrated within yourself is absolutely ridiculous? No, it's not. Is it? This man is crazy. This man is driven by the spiritual demon Satan. And the only guide and warning that we have comes from the scriptures, comes from the Bible, man. And it's very important that Akiam all across the world take heed to what they're looking at, man. This is not a controversy. This is just a fact. It's just true. This is what this man wants to do. So let's talk about this a little bit. Lord willing, this is edifying for you, Akiam. And, you know, please leave your comments on the comment board and any scriptures that may come to mind. With no further ado, when you skip down into this article, I'm going down to the fifth page. It says, executive summary, new technologies supported by advances in encryption and network computing are driving transformational change to the global economy, including in how goods, services, and assets are exchanged. An important development in this process has been the emergence of virtual currencies, VCs. All right, VC schemes are private sector schemes that in many cases facilitate peer-to-peer exchange, bypassing traditional central clearinghouses. VCs and other associated technologies, notably distributed ledger ledgers based on blockchains are rapidly evolving, and the future landscape is difficult to predict. Right now, they're mentioning different things. Okay, one of the most famous things that people know about is Bitcoin and the development of its virtual currency or digital currency.
Digital currency is a digital coin that you can send through the internet. This currency represents value that is not issued by a central bank or government, but is accepted by people as a means of payment for goods and services. Digital currencies have a number of advantages compared to other alternatives. Traditional banks charge fees to process monetary transactions. This increases the cost of everything you buy. They can even freeze your account and refuse to release your money if they choose to. But digital coins can be transferred or exchanged over the internet from person to business, business to business, without going through a bank. This means lower fees, no account freezes, no arbitrary limits, and no restrictions on your account. Your digital coins can be stored in a digital wallet, cloud wallet, or cold storage, and can be traded on a digital currency exchange for other currencies, including the US dollar, the euro, and many others. What is mining? Digital currencies are generated all over the internet by anybody running an application called a digital currency miner. Mining requires a certain amount of work for each reward block of coins. This work is done by solving complex mathematical problems while simultaneously verifying transactions on the digital currency network. All this work is done by software running on specialized computer mining hardware. When two people exchange a digital coin over the internet, other people record and verify that transaction. When your mining hardware has computed and recorded transactions, and you are lucky enough to complete a block, you are rewarded for this work with new digital coins from the network. Why should you mine? Well, one reason is because digital currencies are still in their infancy. In fact, Bitcoin, the first digital currency, was just issued in 2009. Since that time, the value of Bitcoin has risen dramatically. As the difficulty of mining new Bitcoins increases, the value of the coins have also increased. Thousands of merchants, including Dell, Overstock.com, TigerDirect, Newegg, and many more now accept Bitcoin as a direct method of payment for their goods and services. As more places accept digital currency, the value of that currency tends to increase. More and more people are mining digital currencies every day.
All right, we're going to get into that. I want to skip down real quick into the introduction on the sixth page. It says overview. One, new technologies are driving, and you brothers can pull this up and read it. You know, I'm not going to read every single thing because I'm not your, you know, you grown-ass man. Read it, okay? It says in the introduction, number one, new technologies are driving transformational changes in the global economy, including in how goods and services and assets are exchanged. That's what we read earlier. I want to read the bolded part, but I'm going to read this just for edification. The development of monies and variety of payment systems throughout history have helped exchange more efficient and secure. The rapid spread of internet-based commerce and mobile technology, supported by advances in encryption and network computing, has driven the development of several innovative technologies. Companies such as Uber and Airbnb have developed radical new business models. Okay, let's skip down. Number two, the important development in this process of transformation has been the emergence of virtual currencies. VCs, in principle, question the paradigm of state-supported fiat currencies and the dominant role that central banks and conventional financial institutions have played in the operation of the financial system. All right? VCs are issued without the involvement or backing of a state. Some VC schemes make use of distributed ledger technologies that provide complete and secure transaction records without the use of central registry. So when you look at the whole Bitcoin institution, you're able to buy and trade, you know, without it going through some type of financial institution. This money is all digital, and its value comes from the people who basically put into the pot. All right. But the thing that you have to understand is that, do you think the elite are going to allow for that? Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Because when you saw Bitcoin when it first came out, you had all the pundits and the elite were using the media to basically demonize Bitcoin. All right? And say, you know, it can cause these potential problems, that and that, this and this and that. Meanwhile, as you see here, we're on the IMF webpage. Do you think the IMF itself would allow for this entity like Bitcoin and other things to take over the market without having some type of backup plan or a plan itself? You know, of course they're going to. All right. So let's skip down. It says virtual currencies and their underlying distributed ledger technologies have the potential to generate benefits. All right. It's talking about how it has efficiency by facilitating peer-to-peer exchange while reducing transaction time and costs, especially across borders. How basically it can just make transactions much easier. All right, when you especially let's say you was buying a house, and if you have these virtual currencies, you just trade those currencies, bing, bang, bada boom, done. You know, it's all secured and encrypted and protected, you know. All right, so number four, it says, however, these technologies pose risks. What type of risks? It says money laundering, terrorist financing, tax evasion, and other forms of illicit activity. While risks to the conduct of monetary policy seem less likely to arise, risks to financial stability may eventually emerge as the new technologies come to a more widespread use. Although the growing use of distributed ledger technologies outside of the content of virtual currencies pose far fewer risks, it may over time pose a serious challenge to parts of the business model of the established financial system. Okay, and then right here they're hinting at it, they're still hinting that it's better than what we got. It might pose some risks. So the IMF is alluding to we're looking into this. Okay. Number five, it says any policy response to virtual currencies will need to strike an appropriate balance between forcibly addressing risks and abuses while avoiding overregulation that could stifle innovation. Yeah, right. Okay. Number six, this paper discusses the potential benefits and risks posed by VCs, blah, 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 blah. That's all I want to read on that. So you know that the IMF itself, it has already made plans to incorporate virtual currencies in its future projects. When you read this paper, it talks about how more research needs to be done and how we need to do that and need to do this. Well, if you listen to the interview that I put at the beginning of this video, you know that since the early 90s, they've already been looking into this technology and how they can use it in the future. And you already know, most likely, they've been looking into this stuff probably since the 70s or maybe even earlier than that. Okay? So I want to read this article real quick. This is from ZeroHedge.com. It was written also January 20th, 26. War on cash escalates. China readies digital currency. International Monetary Fund says extremely beneficial. Which this is what we was reading here in this PDF page. How they felt like it was extremely beneficial. Brothers can go to that. It says, remember when Bitcoin and its digital currency cohorts were slammed by authorities and written off by the elite as worthless? Well, now, as the war on cash escalates, officials from the IMF to China are seeing the opportunity to control the world's money through virtual cashless currencies. All right? Just as we warned most recently here, state wealth control is the goal. And as Bloomberg reports, the PBOC is targeting an early rollout of China's own digital currency to boost control of money. And none other than the IMF's Christine Lagarde added that virtual currencies are extremely beneficial. Okay? Let me see what else they got down here. It says, these limits are broadly called capital controls. Why now? Why are governments suddenly so keen to ban physical cash? The answer appears to be that banks and government authorities are anticipating bail-ins, steeply negative interest rates, and hefty fees on cash. And they want to close any opening regular depositors might have to escape these forms of officially sanctioned debt. the escape mechanism from bail-ins and fees and cash deposits is physical cash, and hence the sudden flurry of calls to eliminate cash as a relic of a bygone age, that is, an age when commoners had some way to safeguard their money from bail-ins and banks to control. Because whenever everything's uploaded into this digital economy, you know, the central banks are going to have full control over basically everything. And them being able to put this inside each person is going to just merge their synthetic godhood, you know. They'll be able to basically upload you into their digital brain, into their digital world. They will be your digital gods, okay? They will be able to see all and know all and have all power within that framework and world. That's what they want to do, man. They want total control, man. They want to be the gods of this world. That's the whole goal. All right? And you can see them slowly implementing this stuff into society. They're eliminating cash. They're eliminating it. And they're consolidating information into their technology. And they're doing it. You got your iPhone with the iCloud. All right. And Samsung has the same thing. This is where you store all your information in some cloud in the sky. All right? To make it more convenient for you, it can never be stolen. You can never lose it. It's secure. All right? And what they're going to start doing is making it to where if you want to use cash, you're going to have to jump through ridiculous amounts of hoops. Basically, it's going to be impossible for you to be a peon, you know, living check to check, and sustain the fees and regulations of carrying cash or even just a credit card. Having the microchip is going to be the most convenient way for you to take care of yourself and your children. And the people are going to eat it up. They're going to beg for it. And it's happening right in front of our faces. Okay? Let's see what else.
The new environment is hostile to savers, okay? And so what is the prospects here? Well, first of all, they're trying to take paper money out of the system. They want everything to go to the new electronic control grid. Even Europe is removing paper currency from circulation when they recently announced removing the 500 euro note, okay? So in essence, Bitcoin is just another example of a computerized system of market order and routing with built-in regulation. All right, and that's why they rolled Bitcoin out to the public so you could get used to it. You think, oh, since the dollar's dying, this will get us there, you know, we can use this and the government can't regulate it. No, the government created it, thus the government regulates it. It's all part of this system, all right, and you're going to see that.
It says, right here, it says, and so now we see China pushing for the early unleashing its own virtual currency. As Bloomberg reports, issuing of digital currency can help reduce costs, curb crimes and money laundering, facilitate transactions, and boost central banks' control on money supply and circulation. PBOC, you know, People's Bank of China, says in statement on website after concluding a seminar today. In this statement, People's Bank of China digital currency seminar held in Beijing, from the People's Bank, Citibank, blah blah blah. Hold on, let me just skip down to get to good juicy stuff. All right, right here in the third paragraph, it says the meeting held that China's current economy under the new norm explore the central bank issued digital currency as a positive practical significance and far-reaching historical significance. It can reduce the traditional distribution of digital currency note issue, the high cost of circulation, improve convenience and transparency of economic transaction, and reduce money laundering, tax evasion, and other criminal acts to enhance the central bank's money supply, all right, and currency in circulation control, better support economic and social development, the full realization of inclusive financial health, future digital currency issuance, Future digital currency issuance circulation systems also help build our new financial infrastructure. Construction further improve China's payment system, improve payment and settlement efficiency, promote economic quality and efficiency upgrade. So basically they're saying the issuance is of this digital currency is just going to make the economy flow a lot more smoothly and reduce certain fraud and other risks that you have when you have paper money in circulation. Okay, they can save a lot of money from having to print it, and monitoring the money is going to be a lot easier digitally than it would be, you know, hand to hand. All right, and it, you know, it's ironic because China was one of the first people that developed paper money. Because carrying money, carrying loads and loads of stuff back in the ancient world, let's say you travel, you know, from southeastern part of China, and then you was going over into India to make a trade. Well, you make that trade, you gonna carry all that money back? Well, somebody gonna rob you on the way. So they would just issue paper money, okay? It just made sense, all right? And so this is just nothing but a piece of the process that Esau wants to do to control these things. Because you got to remember, what controls China? It's the central banks, man. So if China is thinking about this stuff, you don't think that the rest of the world has already got these plans in order? Absolutely. Now, this is an article right here that I saw, and I thought it was interesting. I'm going to read a little bit out of it also. And it's from thestreet.com. It was written in May 10th, 2016. It says the real reason governments are getting into digital currencies like Bitcoin. All right. When you go down to the beginning, it says now governments worldwide are looking into launching their own digital currencies, including Canada, China, Ecuador, the Philippines, and the United Kingdom. Some say that governments have other motivations besides just helping their citizens save time and money. They say that replacing cash transactions with digital currency would mean that there would be more financial surveillance. And many people think that the government already knows enough about this.
This new control system is very difficult for people who don't understand it to operate in it. So they've been rolling it out incrementally in stages. You know, the Bitcoin was just another stage in the evolution of this. Taking money out of the system, charging you now to hold a bank account, charging you if you want to translate the digital credits into paper cash at an ATM machine. All right. SunTrust Bank is going to start charging people now. If you don't have an account there and someone writes you a check from that account, they're going to charge you $7 now if the check is check is over $50. Anything under $50, you won't get charged. But anything over that, they're going to charge you $7 now to convert that paper check into paper money. There is a fee now to do that because they're taking money out of the system. For several years now, banks have been removing cash out of their branches. As you know, bank robberies were something that, you know, were, you know, rampant. And so one of the ideas they had was to basically take the cash out of the bank. And it all made sense because they were already working on rolling out the electronic control grid anyway. So once they got it underway, they said, we don't even need to hold cash anymore. We don't have to worry about bank robberies. So now they hold very little cash in a bank. Some banks have less than $12,000 in it. I'm not kidding. So you need to, that's why you see the armored cars all the time. They're coming and picking up the cash and sending it to the Federal Reserve. That's what they do on a daily basis. All right, we're already in a pseudo cashless society already. Okay, and how is this possible and why is this possible? It's possible because they want to control every aspect of what's going on. That's why the U.S. mimics Rome, because Rome never went away. It still exists. They've set up central banks in every location, in every major continent, and that central bank controls the action on that continent, so that it's one big circle, one big system controlling everything. And they want to enslave the countries to that central bank. And once that electronic part of the system branches out to that section of the continent, then nothing can move or shake in that continent without going through that central bank. So that central bank controls and regulates everything through debt. That's what we do.
This also supports the theory that governments are waging war on cash. The European Central Bank has already decided to get rid of the 500 euro note, and there are calls for the United States to discontinue the $100 bill. What does that mean? They're trying to get this cash off the streets, man. They're trying to bring it on in. They're eliminating cash. Because you're not going to carry all them bills, you're just going to use your card, which has the chip in it. And then they're going to convert that into something else that's more secure. All right? Hello? RFID microchip, mark of the beast. It's exactly what they're doing. It's just true. It's right in your face. It says preventing money laundering and helping control crime and terrorism are given reasons. But less cash and more digital currency will also give central banks and governments more control over the money supply. As it stands, central banks want people and businesses to spend and invest their money instead of saving it, thereby stimulating economic growth and fighting deflation. This is something that we talked about in previous algorithms. You know, you brothers go back and watch previous algorithms. We go into the nature of deflation, all right? And how they create negative interest rates in order to get people to put their money into the game. But nobody wants to put their money into the game because everybody's fucking broke. They maxed out their credit. All right? It says, so they lower interest rates to make hoarding cash in banks unattractive. Like I just said. But low rates haven't done enough for the global economy. And in the past decade, with rates already near zero, banks have started experimenting with negative interest rates. Brothers can stop right now, Google negative interest rates, and then come back to the video. The idea is that banks will prefer to lend the money instead of paying to hold it. This will result in more money available to spend, and this will stimulate the economy. This hasn't had the desired effect. It makes more sense to some bank clients to withdraw their cash and keep it at home rather than paying bank fees while earning zero interest. And this is what the elites want. They've created these situations in the markets. It's all created by design. They're trying to push the people to the edge, all right? And when the people are falling off the cliff, they have this nice soft landing for you already prepared. Okay, just right here, come here. And it's gonna be the mark of the beast system and a new whole new governing economy over the planet Earth, all right?
Eventually what's happening is that we are being led bit by bit through, to use the Skinnerian term, from shaping, through the successive approximation to ultimately having within our bodies an RFID chip that will be implanted, that people will stand in line and in queues for to have, so that ultimately we will have in our bodies, because what we're doing right now, Lindsay, is we're slowly moving towards that. We went from the desktop to the laptop to the phone to the watch, and now we're having little tattoos, little biometrics, all of them leading to the ultimate goal, and that is an RFID, a radio frequency identification or similar chip, to be placed subcutaneously. And that chip, Lindsay, will have everything about you there is. Your bank account, your GPS location, and you will do it. You will get one, because after all, it will also have the siren call of medical information. And then one day, God forbid, not you, one day when people are found guilty of, let's say, crimes, they're not going to be put into the hoosgow, the pokey. No, their chip is going to be turned off and poof, they don't exist anymore. That's where all of this is going.
It's about, with four of the five largest Bitcoin exchanges based in China, it is the largest market for this digital currency. And the most traded currency on Bitcoin exchanges is the Chinese yuan. All right, so guess what currency is going to be incorporated along with the IMF later on this year? The yuan. All right. It's just a piece of the puzzle. It's a piece of the algorithm that they're going to use to push globally.
Welcome back to Currency 365 and breaking historic news. The IMF agrees to include the Chinese yuan RMB in the benchmark, the SDR Special Drawing Rights Currency Basket. All right, so there it is, everybody, from CNBC. JustSurf just sent me the link, and I'm reporting it right now. And it's about 9 minutes ago. Historic moment here by the IMF to include the Chinese yuan RMB in the SDR basket. This will have ripple effects throughout the world as 1 trillion assets will go into the Chinese yuan. This will affect the dollar. This will affect a lot of things that are coming to a lot of the currencies in the SDRs, okay? This is going to be a ripple effect around the world. I don't know if people understand what's about to happen as the SDRs will become the new world order currency as they will settle trades in the SDR, okay? China would probably go, will probably go back, and we probably will see a new dollar, late next year, 2016, and that will probably be go back Treasury Reserve notes. Okay. So there it is. The Chinese yuan is now officially in the SDRs. Now we have to wait for the activation process of it. They're included, but they're not activated yet. Okay. So we have to wait for the activation. They're saying that it could be around September next year, or it was supposed to be January, but it looks like America wanted to push it back to, September. So it could be September. Once it's activated, then I think you're going to see the dollar lose about 30% of its value, and then they'll probably bring out the new dollar. Okay, so a lot of things are going on. It's going to affect your lives in 2016. That is a year that you better be prayed up, because a lot of craziness is coming in 2016 because of this decision, and nobody around the world knows about this because they're just glued to other things. Okay, so this is a historic moment by the IMF. The chief, Christine Lagarde, and her executive board include the Chinese yuan RMB into the SDRs. This is going to change that.
Zero Hedge reports as the war on cash escalates, officials from the IMF to China are seeing the opportunity to control the world's money through virtual cashless currencies. Just as Zero Hedge warned most recently here, state wealth control is the end goal. And as Bloomberg reports, the PBOC is targeting an early rollout of China's own digital currency to boost control of money. And none other than the IMF's Christine Lagarde added that virtual currencies are extremely beneficial. So, my friends, if the IMF thinks that digital currencies are beneficial, then get ready for them to be regulated. The IMF is eyeing them. That's a big red flag, if you ask me. So have fun with your digital coins, your digital bitcoins and all that while you still can, before the global economic stranglehold grabs onto them. Because that's evidently what is about to happen at some point in the future.
Right? No wonder China is leading the charge when it comes to developing a digital currency that it can control. Exchanging paper money for goods or services isn't going away anytime soon, and time will reveal the real motivations of government interest in digital cash, whether it is to help citizens or control. All right? When you go to the beginning of this article, I'm sorry, that was actually page 2, it just talks about how paper money has been around since its invention by the Chinese 1200 years ago. Now China is leading the charge with another monetary innovation, digital currency. Paper money was invented out of necessity. Carrying large bags of metal coins over long distances wasn't practical, and the Chinese businessmen weren't about to cut their profitable trade routes short just because their horses couldn't carry that much weight or because highway bandits were waiting. All right. So, you know, this is during the affluent times of what was known as the Silk Road, how it went all the way from China all the way into Africa and different parts of Europe, and even into the islands of the Mediterranean elsewhere. Okay? It was a huge thing of money and trade. All right? Skipping down, it says the head of the People's Bank of China had recently said that Bitcoin-like cryptocurrency is in development, which will be controlled by the central bank. Which will be controlled by the central bank. See that? This type of digital money has no physical form, but it's created and circulated electronically. And pretty much that's what's already happening today. You call it dollars, you call it this, you call it that, but it's really just numbers on a computer screen. Okay? It's just numbers on a computer screen. The only thing that the elites are going to have to do is figure out a fancy name that people will accept. And he will be able to be your full digital god. Control every part and every aspect of your life, man. Alright? So I want to get this scripture. This is in the book of Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, in the first verse. It says, "The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord Power, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas, in the midst of the people. Yet thou art a man and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of the Most High. Behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that can hide from thee." And what does that mean, wiser than Daniel? What Daniel was an elite scholar of his day, man. He sat in the court of the kings, all right, as a eunuch to the king of Babylon, man. And so, like, if you watch the TV series Marco Polo, you had the Mongol king, or I believe it was Kublai Khan, and he had the people of his court that he would talk to and advise himself with. And these people came from different lands, all right? They were the elite, you know, of those different lands that were trained up in the Khan's court, right? Daniel was one of those men back in the time of Babylon, man. So if you were to make a statement that I was wiser than Daniel, that means you were keen on everything. That means you knew the lands around about. You knew about all types of stuff, man. Astronomy, all right? All types of things, man. So in verse 4, it says, "With thy wisdom and with thy understanding, thou hast gotten thee riches and hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasures." All right? And so what Esau wants to do is fully control the planet Earth using the wisdom that's been given to him to create, you know, this internet, and to back it up with NATO and his military power and be able to push it forth on the people. And the mark of the beast, which we read earlier in the book of Revelation, the 13th chapter, and you continue on into the 14th chapter, it goes and talks about the judgment of receiving that mark, you know, that's a part of this beast systems, you know, implementation of their rulership. The people who believe in this system, who worship the image of the beast, are going to receive the mark of the beast, all right? And that mark is going to have the ability to allow you to buy and sell and maneuver through this society. It's not just an idea in your head that's locked up and nobody can see. No. Esau wants to be able to have godhood over you and be able to track you and be able to say, I know exactly where you are, whenever you are, I control you. In order for him to do that, he has to put himself inside of you, essentially. You have to be uploaded into his system, into his digital brain, into, you know, just as the Most High and his son is looking down on us and they know every hair on our head. But Esau can't just do that shit. He has to figure out a synthetic way to do it. He has to figure out a carnal way to do it. And that carnal way of doing it is the mark of the beast, man. All right? By thy, verse 5, by thy great wisdom and by thy traffic, talking about your economy, thou hast increased thy riches, and thy heart is lifted up because of thy riches. All right? He is moving with that boldness and that pride. But the Most High is set to destroy him. All right? The Most High is set to destroy this man. Okay, I want to get this right quick in Isaiah, the 29th chapter. In the 15th verse, it says, woe unto them that seek deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their works are in the dark. This is the movements of what we call the Illuminati, or the super elite, the Rothschild families and those Edomite banking families that govern and rule all the money, all the legislation. All right, they have all the military might. All right, they got U.S. bases and other European bases all across the planet Earth, man. They're chief in military technology, and they have a foothold in the workings of all these major countries. China too. All right? All you're seeing is a battle of where are we going to base this new world order system out of? Is it going to be based out of here, or is it going to be based out of there? And that's why when you read in the 17th chapter of Revelation, which we've gone in on this on the previous algorithms, that the horns are going to even come up against. The beast is going to, pieces of that beast system are going to fight against itself, man. They're going to destroy themselves in the Third World War by nuclear destruction, okay? So it says, woe unto them that seek deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their works are in the dark. And they say, who seeth us and who knoweth us? Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. For shall the work say of him that made it, he made me not? Or shall the thing framed say of him that framed it, he hath no understanding? See, the elite think that they're working outside of the Most High's algorithm. But the elite are doing exactly what the Most High wants. You're setting yourself up for destruction, perdition, woe. Okay? So it's a beautiful thing. That's why, you know, us over here at Great Millstone, we encourage the elite to push forward with their agenda. Because we know that them pushing forward with their agenda is going to coincide with their imminent destruction. All right? This is Revelation chapter 14, verse 8. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying, with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image, if they worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of wrath of the Most High, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Okay? So those people who receive this mark, who receive this RFID chip, are going to be destroyed by the wrath of the Heavenly Father. So those of us who believe in the scriptures, who believe in the words of Yahweh Shem Yahushua, you know, we're not worried about this, man. We're going to do what we have to do to avoid this destruction. And, you know, we have faith that Yahusha is going to deliver us in those times. With that, I want to give all praise and glory to Yahweh Bashem Yahusha. I want to send double honors once again to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Much peace, love, and salutation to you, Akiyama, out there pushing his word in sincerity and truth. You know, keep fighting. We almost there to the end. All hell is getting ready to break loose. Shalom.